I'm Anthony Valeri, Director of Investment Management in Wealth and Fiduciary Services. Thanks very much for joining our spring market update as we take a look at the economy and financial markets here after the end of the first quarter with a look towards the remainder of 2022. I'll start with a review of commentary, touch on economic commentary, then go into stock and bond markets, and of course hit major themes in the markets such as the Russia-Ukraine war and persistent high inflation. So let's get right into it. Let's review the first quarter performance in financial markets. And it was a tough one for investors. Not much worked in the first quarter. Negative returns, as many of you are aware, over the first quarter. Only commodities positive to start the year, and we're positive by a fairly firm amount, as you can see there. But when you look at other strategies and some of the major indices like the Dow Jones Industrials, the S&P 500, high yield bonds, high quality bonds, all of them were negative. So a challenging quarter for investors to say the least. Even high quality bonds and municipal bonds down over 5%, municipals down over 6% for the first 3 months of the year. For the record, that is for the high quality taxable bonds, the third worst quarterly performance on record going all the way back to the mid 1970s. So just to put that in context, really tough quarter for bond investors and equity investors alike. So really not much reprieve after a strong 2021, definitely due for a pullback. In terms of sector performance in the US equity market, the defensive sectors led performance, energy, utilities, and consumer staples. You can see the price index of the S&P 500. When you have that sort of defensive leadership, it does show caution in the market, and we're likely that will continue to influence market behavior going forward. We'll talk more about that. Let's get into diversification, and both stocks and bonds did not work during the first quarter of 2022. It is extremely rare that that's the case. If you look here, this is data all the way back to the mid 1970s, the frequency of when stocks and bonds are both positive, whether stocks positive, bonds negative, and then bonds positive, stocks negative, and then both negative. And you can see only 19% of the time are both negative in any given quarter. So it is rare. And back-to-back negative quarters are even more rare, happened only 9 times going back over that 40-year plus time frame. So an extremely rare occurrence to get back-to-back negative quarters. We do think there's better value in the bond market. We'll talk more about that after that punishing sell-off. But again, important to note, diversification didn't work, but it is rare, and we do think diversification will be back in favor going forward. So a tough first quarter. We do think, again, bonds one area that we'll see some likely better performance going forward. I think it'll be a choppy market for equities, and I'll get more into that. Let me get to the economy and talk about some of the recession risks, which have really made their way through the media. Before I really touch on that, we do not expect a recession. We do expect a slowdown. Looking at the labor markets, probably exhibit A as to just how strong this economy still is, and it's more a case of a slowdown. On the left, you see the US labor force, 3-month change, over 2.5 million people have returned to the labor force. So the stories of the great resignation, people resigning, that has dramatically changed over the last several months as people return to the labor force, and that is a key underpinning of the strength in the labor market. On the right, the JOLTS job openings from the US Treasury Department, still near a record high listing of job openings, over 11 million job openings. That exceeds the number of open or the unemployed individuals by more than 5 million. So to see that level of strength in the labor market certainly runs counter to any recession fears. When you look at the other components of the economy, business investment still very robust. This is capital goods orders, excluding defense and aircraft, and growing at a 10% annualized rate. Yes, it is slowing, but that is a healthy level of growth, and also not indicative of a recession. If we turn to the consumer, the average consumer is still in very good financial health. This is the household financial obligations ratio. It's produced by the Federal Reserve, and it's quarterly data. This is at the end of December or end of 2021. And what it does is measure the interest expense burden on consumers. And it's not just mortgage debt, it's any kind of revolving debt, credit cards, auto payments. And you can see that as a this ratio, as a percentage of income, that it is very low by a historical perspective and nowhere near what we saw between 2005 and 2007. So the consumers in good financial health, the consumer spending is growing at a mid-single digit rate, even after taking account the impact of inflation. So healthy consumer spending that will likely slow but remains healthy, and consumers in having strong balance sheets really runs counter to the idea of a recession. So all in all, consumer doing well, and there is pent-up demand to support that. Here is the TSA traveler throughput at U.S. airports has been steadily increasing. This is some of the highest metrics we've seen since the pandemic started as individuals are looking to travel, and again, reflects strength in their ability, despite inflation, to continue to spend. So we're seeing activity pick up and reflect pent-up demand that should continue to support the economy. Now, the negative inflation at a 40-year high. This morning, the consumer price index was released up 8.5%, slightly above expectations. However, the core component actually was a little weaker than expected, and that's giving the bond market some help today, a little bit of a relief rally in the U.S. bond market. As that core was weaker, suggests that we might be seeing the peak in inflation, and indeed, we do believe inflation will peak here in the second quarter. The summer months and through the remainder of 2022 should see some harder year-over-year comparisons, and the acceleration in some of those underlying components just very far away from the rates we saw last summer. So we do see a deceleration, but inflation likely to remain elevated through the remainder of the year. But some positive indications, the silver lining, if you will, that inflation very close to peaking should provide some release. I should mention that this is where the Ukraine-Russia war impacts will be seen. Banking linkages between Russia and the rest of the world, very limited. The U.S. only at 0.1% exposure to Russian banks. In Europe, it's approximately 1%. So that financial contagion, very, very unlikely. GDP growth from Russia and Ukraine still together is approximately 2% of world GDP growth. But where you'll see it is in inflation, and that's a bit of a wild card that we still need to wait and see. Russia and Ukraine comprise over 25% of the world's grain output, and Russia is responsible for roughly 10% of a host of industrial metals and precious metals that are used in manufacturing. So that remains to be an issue to see what that impact will be going forward on the economy and consumer spending. But at least some sign that inflation is peaking over the near term. But again, too early to ultimately evaluate. Now, if we move on to what does that mean for investors? Well, that high inflation has translated into rate hike expectations from the Federal Reserve. These yellow bars represent the market implied rate hike expectation. This is measured by the futures market in the bond market, showing what investors expect. And the blue is what the Fed forecast at their last Fed meeting in March. And you can see the gold bars are above the Fed forecast. Markets have moved very aggressively to price in rate hikes. In fact, producing a year or expected overnight rate at year end of just north of 2.5%. That's almost 9 quarter basis point rate hikes over the remaining 6 Fed meetings. So yes, the bond market is pricing in at least a couple 0.5% increases at the upcoming Fed meeting, the one in May. There's a 90% probability of a 50 basis point rate hike that is coming down after today's inflation report. But still, markets have priced in a lot from the Fed. What you'll note here too is those yellow bars go down starting in 2024. That means the bond market is telling the Fed that they are risking a policy error by raising rates too fast and too high, just as the economy is slowing on its own. So some potential risks from the Fed if they hike too aggressively, something to watch going forward. So that's the market expectation from the Fed. That is one reason why we expect improvement in the bond market going forward. However, those rate hike expectations are fueling recession worries. You've probably read about the yield curve flattening or getting inverted, and indeed an inverted yield curve has preceded every recession since 1950. Take the one before the pandemic as with a grain of salt, but that blue line is the 2 year and 10 year, one of the most widely followed, and that did dip below zero in late March. It has since bounced back to a 20 basis point spread, but not all segments of the yield curve are forecasting a recession, which is indicated by the gray bars here. That 10-month, or probably 3-month to 10-year measure of the yield curve is firmly positive and expanding, which suggests they're sending a growth signal. Still wouldn't dismiss the 2 and 10-year. We view it more as a sign of a slowdown, but not a recession. So something to watch, but certainly yield curves are not unanimous in forecasting a recession currently. The other factor not supporting a recession is the corporate bond market. This is the high yield bond market, the average yield spread to comparable maturity treasuries. And that remains below 4%, which in turn is below the period average of almost 5%. So yield spreads are below their average. They have increased a bit, but not seeing the type of weakness in the corporate market that would indicate signs of credit losses and a potential recession. So the corporate bond market holding steady. Let's turn our attention to the equity markets. And there are some headwinds and why we think that volatility is likely to persist over the remainder of the year, likely to be another choppy quarter and one that will continue to maybe frustrate investors. But we do think it's still prudent to stick with a long-term investment plan. But we'll frame that here over the next several slides and some of the headwinds for equity markets going forward. One is obviously the Fed. If you look back at the last four times the Fed raised rates, and here we index the S&P 500 performance to the timing of the first Fed rate hike. And you can see leading up to the first rate hike, you have mixed performance, but then the first and second months after that first rate hike has typically been challenging for equities. They tend to weaken after that first rate hike before ultimately moving higher again and getting past the impact of Fed rate hikes. We do think that interest rates in the low 2%, very manageable for stocks. It's not until the 10-year gets to 4, 4.5 that we would become more concerned. But some near-term volatility based on history and the Fed hiking rates. Also, this is a midterm election year, and historically they have been challenging for the equity market. You can see the monthly performance here in a midterm election year, very limited returns through the first 9 months of the year before performance picks up later in that year. In fact, what's not shown here is the 12 months after the midterm election have historically been a very good time to invest and actually never been negative since 1950. So a good time long before after that, but until then, the midterm election year likely to support some additional choppiness. The prospects of tax increases are certainly been reduced given inflation and the focus on Ukraine. However, we can't fully rule that out as we look at a potential build back smaller bill coming from Washington. Higher inflation suggests lower valuations for the S&P 500. Historically, you can see where the PE ratio has been for the S&P 500 for a varying inflation range. And as you move to the right and the higher inflation, the lower the PE ratio, which means the higher inflation, the lower valuation you receive on equities. So something we are watching, and again, a headwind to keep those valuations in check. They have come down due to the strength in earnings. We'll talk more about that in a moment, but higher inflation, all else equal, a headwind for valuations, and rising rates, also a headwind for stocks. Although again, not still low enough that it shouldn't be problematic for equities until we get to a higher range. But again, all else equal, as interest rates are higher, they pressure stock valuations lower. So a couple of headwinds coming. Again, the uncertainty really is best measured by earnings. We are just a couple days away from an acceleration in earnings reporting season. This has been the key driver of equities over the last 2 years. There's been lots of negative comments that it's a valuation pump, but there has been tremendous profit growth in the S&P 500. If you look back to the second quarter of 2020, the gold bar shows where earnings ultimately came in, and the blue represents the initial forecast. And there's been a consistent pattern of earnings beating expectations, and in several cases by a wide, wide margin. That strength in earnings has been extraordinary and a key driver of equity prices over the last 2 years. As we head into first quarter earnings, the 6% is the expectation. Should note that much of that coming from earnings, and many, a few sectors actually expecting a decline year over year. So the earnings picture is a bit of a challenge. Don't know what the first quarter will come in. We'll see how much companies will actually say that higher input prices are adversely impacting profits. So far, they've been able to pass along those price increases, but how long can they continue to do that? So this presents another challenge to equities. The strength of earnings in 2022 should come in the third and fourth quarter. So this will be a slowly developing scenario for investors to watch. Ultimately, we do think earnings grow or are positive year over year. And I think that's the key to remain invested in equities and expect positive performance from here forward. So we'll watch that earnings season, a key one to watch. And we talked about inflation and used this slide in our last webinar. Still important to remember that stocks are the best hedge against inflation over the longer term. Here's showing the acceleration in CPI inflation on six different occasions going back to the late 80s. You can see the low and high in the consumer price index and the subsequent change. In five of those six occasions, the S&P annualized return has been positive, with an average return of near 9%. So important to note that stocks do still provide your best protection over the longer term against inflation. We think commodities are too volatile to effectively incorporate in a portfolio. Now let me shift to the bond market. And we're seeing, as I mentioned, a lot of rate hikes priced in. One way to measure that is to compare the yield on the two-year treasury, which exceeded 2.5% at one point, and compare that to the target Fed funds rate, which the Fed sets. That spread reached almost 2% the other day, and that is a very rare occurrence. Since 1990, the spread of the 2 year when it were over the Fed funds has exceeded 1.5% only 17 times. That's using monthly data. The subsequent 12-month return averaged 12.2%. The Bloomberg Aggregate Bond Index return on average over that same time period was 5.9%. So certainly a well above historical average return for that 12-month period. It does show you that when there's a lot of fear priced into the bond market, that your forward returns are better. So as painful as it's been, there is light at the end of the tunnel here for bond investors, and do think there is opportunity being priced into the bond market. One other way to see that is in the municipal bond market, where we see municipal yields rising alongside that of U.S. Treasuries. Again, a historic increase in bond yields over the first quarter, and you're finally getting some yield, some income in the bond market. Here are average AAA municipal bond yields on the left for 10 and 30 year in the blue. You can see the increase there, the 10 year back up over 2.5, 30 year up over 3. That translates to some attractive taxable equivalent yields and right around 5, depending on which state you're in for a 10 year. And then for the valuation perspective, when we compare municipals as a percentage of treasuries on the right, you're getting municipal yields that are almost roughly in line with the comparable treasuries. That's the first time we've seen that since late 2020. And that is a sign of cheapening valuations. It's a reflection of the turmoil and selling pressure in the municipal market over the month of February and March in particular. And to get these better valuations, I think is notable and something investors may wish to take advantage of, given how much Fed rate hikes are priced into the market and the fact that inflation may be peaking. So still low on a historical basis, but certainly some opportunity developing in the bond market. So that's our view of the economy and financial markets. There's some challenges on the horizon for the for equity investors, but we strongly advise staying invested, riding out this volatility, and be rewarded over the longer term. I'm Anthony Valeri. Thanks for listening.